Welcome to Your Voice. I'm Julia Locandy. Today I'm going to talk with Senator George Maziarz about what's going on in Western New York and the New York State Senate. It's great to be with you again,
Julia.
Senator.
Good to be with you too, Julia.
The Senate passed a package of bills that would crack down harder on impaired and reckless driving.
Right.
You had a bill among them that would create new penalties for people supervising a driver while under the influence of drugs or alcohol. Tell us about
Abigail's. It's called Abigail's Law. It was a result of a horrific tragedy in Orleans County in upstate New York. An individual who was clearly intoxicated was at a party. He forced his a relative, a 17-year-old young girl, to drive him at night in not very good weather conditions to a store to obtain more beer. And he put his 8-year-old daughter, a little girl named Abigail, in the back seat of the car. And obviously, as I said, that it was bad weather, it was dark, and this the 17-year-old driver was in an accident, ran off the road, and this 8-year-old beautiful little girl with red hair on the screen right now, Abigail, was killed in the accident. And the Orleans County District Attorney, Joe Cardone, unfortunately, found that there were very minor, minimal criminal charges that he could bring against the adult in the car, the person who was intoxicated. He wasn't driving the car. He forced the 17-year-old to drive the car. You know, she was 17 years old, young person. I think she had a learner's permit. She didn't even have a driver's license. Mm-hmm. She was driving illegally, clearly, was unable to drive under these conditions. And this poor little beautiful 8-year-old girl ended up being killed because of it. So who's the responsible person? Criminally, according to the DA, there was very little criminal responsibility to go around because of the law. We have a majority sponsor in the assembly. Assemblyman Steve Hawley, who also represents Orleans County, is a co-sponsor of the bill. Aileen Gunther, she's from downstate. I went to her, Assemblyman Hawley and I went to her, showed her this example, showed her the picture of this beautiful little girl, and she is really pushing this bill on the assembly side. I think this is something that everyone agrees that clearly this was a loophole in the law. Yeah. That here you had a responsible adult, obviously intoxicated, forcing this young girl to drive the car, gets in an accident, this beautiful little 8-year-old loses her life, and really, other than some very minor criminal charges, no one was held accountable or responsible for the death of this little girl. It's absolutely tragic and atrocious.
Yeah. So this will create new.
This will create new penalties for an individual who, under these circumstances, is a supervising driver.
Right.
I mean, this young girl, the 17-year-old, who was the driver of the car. I mean, he was considered to be the supervising adult in that car, under the current DMV law. So it would hold him responsible for it. It's a shame that it had to take this incident for something like this to come to light. I laud the DA, Joe Cardone, did all he could to hold this individual responsible. But under New York State law, there's very little he could do.
Right.
So, it's another, as you said, there were a package of DWI bills that we passed in the Senate. There's just so many tragedies across the state that happen every year. And, hopefully people will get the message that you're going to drink and drive. You're going to pay the price.
Yeah. I understand that the governor and his staff came to Buffalo to talk about his budget.
The governor was in Buffalo this week to talk about the budget. He did a great job. It was a standing room only crowd at the Buffalo Convention Center. I introduced the governor. I was there with my colleagues from Western New York, Senator Grisanti, and the assembly folks were there. And it was just a rehash of some of the major points of the state budget. The governor talked about how we're going to close the deficit, increase in school aid. We, as a delegation, expressed to the governor our concern, particularly about the aid to education, the additional $800 million that's being proposed, a 4% increase that the governor is talking about, that in the last 2 years, rural school districts and small city school districts have been disproportionately singled out for higher cuts, let's say, than other areas, so that, you know, we should make it up to those areas. So I did meet this Saturday, in fact, with school districts from Niagara and Orleans County, and also with their superintendents. Senator John Flanagan, my colleague who chairs the Senate Education Committee, was there, and we had a very good meeting, what I thought was a very productive meeting, talking about the budget. Back to the governor talked obviously about the $1 billion incentive package for Western New York. In fact, when I introduced the governor, I urged the crowd to give him a $1 billion welcome to Buffalo and Western New York. You know, it's going to be challenging, but the governor was very positive. He was very upbeat. He was very good. I think the fact that he chose to come to Western New York, right after his budget presentation, I believe that was the first regional presentation that he did. I know that some of his surrogates have been out in other areas of the state, but I think he came to Western New York because, quite frankly, the economy is hurting there, and he wanted to send the right message.
Yeah, he seems to be putting a lot of incentives into Western New York.
Yes.
Into Western New York.
Yeah, I think he, you know, when you look at the unemployment rates in the state of New York across mm-hmm. statewide, it's generally the highest ones are in Western New York, Niagara Falls and Buffalo, followed very closely by the North Country. It's sort of unusual because you look at one of the best incentives that we have, and you know I'm going to get this into the energy field, but, you know, is the cheap hydropower, and we produce more of it in Western New York, and then secondarily up in the North Country with the St. Lawrence Project, and yet we continually in Western New York and North Country have the highest rates of unemployment. When you look at the largest drop in population under the census, it was in Buffalo and Niagara Falls. So I think the governor sees all of those statistical data, and he wants to be helpful, and I think he's trying to be helpful. I think he's challenged us as a Western New York delegation to reach out to companies. I've already reached out to several CEOs of Fortune 500 companies and said, look, the way the world today is for states to be competitive with incentive packages, and this is a $1 billion incentive package. I don't know if there's many of them that are out there that will equal $1 billion, but yeah. I think the governor's serious.
Mm-hmm. You mentioned the census, and the proposed new lines that would make up your district came out this week.
Yes.
What is your reaction to the new makeup of the area you represent?
Well, I'm very positive about it. First, just to give some of our listeners a little bit of a brief background on it, every 10 years, once the census figures are certified and out, and they are, there has to be a shifting of district lines for the Senate, for the Assembly, for the congressional lines. My new proposed district will still stretch pretty much the same from Monroe County into Niagara County. The big difference is I will represent all of Niagara County. I will represent the city of Niagara Falls. One of the criterias, there are actually two criterias that came into play with my district. First of all, mine is sort of unusual in that, you know, I have Lake Ontario to the north of me, the Niagara River to the west of me. So you can't draw the lines into Canada. So I was sort of pretty safe to begin with anyway. Reapportionment is something that, quite frankly, a lot of newspapers tend to be interested in it. When I'm doing my town hall meetings or when I'm out on the stump, very few people actually bring it up to me. But one area that a lot of people did talk to me, particularly in the western end of my district in Niagara County, was why was Niagara County 90% of this, or maybe 80% of the county was in one Senate district and the city of Niagara Falls was not. So this actually, I would say, corrects that problem. One of the criteria was to keep communities of interest together and not unless under some very special circumstances to break county lines. So clearly Niagara County, with a population of approximately 220,000, could, if we could keep a county like that all whole, that was a positive going forward, and they did. Senator Grisanti currently represents the city of Niagara Falls. So after the next election, and I know that the newspaper, one of our local newspapers had a headline, it said, Maziar's district to include Niagara Falls, and I was sort of flattered by that, but there still has to be an election. So it's going to be the 62nd district that will include the city of Niagara Falls, And that's all of Niagara County, all of Orleans County, and in two towns, the town of Sweden and the town of Ogden in Monroe County. So right now, I currently represent five towns in Monroe and part of the city of Rochester. I will lose three towns in Monroe and the city of Rochester and just represent Ogden and Sweden, both of which are very good towns. Ogden has the village of Spencerport in it. That's sort of the base of Ogden. And in Sweden has the village of Brockport, kind of the base of the town of Sweden. I've represented both of them now for a long time. They have excellent local elected officials. I work very well with them. And I look forward to, hopefully, if the voters choose to continue to represent them. But the city of Niagara Falls presents a lot of challenges, and I look forward to those challenges. You know, the city is, we pointed out in the census, you know, had the largest population drop. Unemployment rate in the city of Niagara Falls today, right now, is around 12%. I mean, you look at it nationally, it's like 7, and the president is concerned about the national rate being at 7. Niagara Falls is 12%. We've got to do something about getting jobs and employment opportunities in the city of Niagara Falls. It's a real challenge. I look forward to it.
All right. And these are proposed lines. What happens now? Tell us what happens now.
Now, there are hearings held across the state. Clearly, there are some areas that will need some technical corrections to them. Hopefully, mine is not one of them. Mine's pretty clear. All of Orleans, all of Niagara, that's probably 90% of the district, and then these two towns in Monroe County. But I, generally in urban areas, in the city of New York, city of Buffalo, the lines there are around neighborhoods and everything. And, you know, you have to keep communities of interest together. And, you know, communities of interest can be defined as minority communities, ethnic communities, geographic communities. So there'll be hearings. I'm sure that people will come to those hearings and testify. And this is a process that no one, in the end, is going to be happy with. There will be criticism by editorial boards, by special interest groups. Everybody will be, in the end, complaining about this. I think, Senator Nozzolio, who heads the task force for the Senate, and Assemblyman Jack McEnany, I saw an interview that Assemblyman McEnany did on one of the local television shows, and he said that if everybody is not happy, we probably did a good job. So I'm happy.
The Niagara Business Association Awards event, you went to that, right?
It's actually the Town of Niagara Business Association. Town of Niagara is a great, booming local town headed by Supervisor Steve Richards. Their business association had their annual awards banquet. This is a relatively small town in population. I think it's around 9,000. Now, if it's not 9,000, I'm sure the supervisor is going to call me later on and correct me. But they have a very strong, very active business association. It was a sellout crowd. They honored a whole lot of individuals, both businesses and individuals. Margie Blakely was their Citizen of the Year. She was somebody who worked at the credit union there for a long time. It was great. And you know what it is? It's small businesses. These are mom and pop type businesses. These are homespun businesses. And it was really a positive thing. But I go to an event like that, and I'm like walking on air when I come out of it, because people there remind me so much of my late mother and father. You know, they were struggling to raise a family, to have a couple of bucks at the end of the week, and I just feel real good about it.
I
congratulate all the awardees. And there was one young gentleman there. He worked at Wegmans supermarkets, got an award. I think he was like 23 years old or something, you know. So he's on a management track at Wegmans. He's going to do fine.
Okay. Thank you so
Thanks,
much for
Julia.
Your time.
Okay.
Thank you for watching Your Voice. For any additional information, you can log on to the Senator's website, maziarz.nysenate.gov.